Start through very quickly and go through the different types. Plan to be practical, put a large tank in someone's backyard, but that's the ideal. Because realistically, if you look at even this small roof, would be about, I don't know, say it's 10 by 15 metres, 10 metres by 15, 150 square metres, which is a very small house. 150 square metres in our rainfall is roughly 150,000 litres. So some people think they're going to put a little sling line down the side of the house, which is 2,500 litres, and that's going to make a difference. Well, it'll fill up, I can't do the maths very quickly, but it'll fill up how many times? 60 times? But it won't. It'll fill up in one shower and you'll waste most of the water. So when you think about rainwater, think of how much space can I sacrifice in my backyard or wherever and put the biggest tank you can in, knowing that it will fill up 6-7 times. That's the cycle. And if you had something like a 9,000 litre tank, which is about 2.5 metres diameter, and that filled up 5, 6, 7 times in the course of the winter and rains, that would offset your water budget by 65% for your laundry and toilet. So you've got to think of big tanks as best as small tanks. But on the other hand, could we put lots of slimline tanks in because people don't have room? Big houses, small blocks. We're starting to do many of these, dairy tanks in people's front yards, backyards, and they put the alfrescos and decking over and that kind of stuff. But they're typically 4,000 litres to 7,000 litres. We put in some bigger concrete tanks, but they're more expensive, obviously. But something like that, a tank, an install, would be, you know, the machines on supervising tank, about 2,500, 2,700, 2,800, you know, $2,500 plus just get the tank in without anything else. And then if you have a bit of room over some decking or verandas or anything, pole, maybe you can put a bladder in. And these are a little bit more expensive again, so maybe it's the way they make them, etc. But the beauty about it, of course, you can make it as long as you like. And roughly as wide as you like between the holes, you can actually get them custom built, and they're pretty easy, but they are not cost effective in a sense. Slim lines are very popular. People don't have the room, they've got down the side of the house, the fence line, they've got inside the garage, around the back of the garage, and they might put 2 or 3 tanks in series. Something is better than nothing. No, if you can't put a big tank in, people putting some tanks in and getting some water to offset the water budget. And the thing about rainwater tanks is simply that what we want to try to do by putting in big tanks is to plunge to your house. You not have the thought that you're putting a rainwater tank saving it for summer for irrigation. That's a silly idea. The rain is falling in winter. I want to use the water inside the home. I want to use that 9,000 litres to flush the toilets, to wash my clothes, do that inside the home. And then I'll fill up again, I'll keep using it. That's when you make the difference. So you don't have the idea, I'm going to save it. You use it in the winter, you plumb it to your home. Yeah, you can use it for irrigation, you want to get a big tank. But offset the water budget. Rainwater tank, plumb it up to your laundry. You wash your clothes, you grab the laundry water, has rainwater on the garden. Then you start making differences to in the water budget. So most tanks that we install, for example, are round tanks above ground, they're the cheapest, and you see that there's a whole lot of things you can do to make better quality water. You might need some kind of switching device. I mean, there's lots of different types. There's some examples of ones on tanks, on walls. And this allows steam water to go back into your home. So you've got your rainwater plumbed up to a device which sends the water to wherever. You've also got steam water coming in as well, so that you've actually basically continue to flush the toilet when you're out of rainwater. So if I just quickly show you something like this. So you might have, there's the tank water going through a filter obviously first, and you might have steam water coming in and out of there. In water coming in and out there, there's your rainwater tank water coming up from the bottom. In this case, tank water through a press control through the device, there's your steam in, there's your water out to the home. That kind of scenario of a pump, typically a submersible pump, and a switching device could be $1,000 to $1,500 typically. So let's give you an idea what you're up for there. So there are things you need to be mindful too. I mean, years ago when I was a boy, we had a rainwater tank, a lot of people did, and it went straight from the gutter into the tank. And of course, when I was a teenager, I was pretty scarred for life to look inside and saw dead rats and lizards and mosquito wrigglers. My dad put kerosene on there and made it all safe. So we don't do that these days, all right? What we're trying to do is put in things like leaf eaters, first flush devices, the water gets screened, falls down, drips away, little ball floats up here, then all the good water goes into the tank. Or if you've got a wet system, we have it coming up from the floor up into the tank. Same drips away here, setting a little first flush, then good water. You want to dump the first, you know, half a millimetre of water to get rid of all the bird poop, get rid of all the dust. So when it rains, dumps all that first. Then you're collecting good water. You don't want to have dirty water going to your toilet or washing your clothes. So you need to invest in a little bit of protection for your system. And of course, there are maintenance things to be done as well. And if you don't clean out the leaf eater, this one over here, we'll go to school. Well, whose responsibility comes in schools? So if you don't clean out the stuff that does accumulate like this, you waste the water. You need to make sure you've got insect traps so you don't get mosquitoes breeding in there. And you need to unscrew the first flush device and get the filter out, and you can see the cake of stuff that happens just from the roof. I'm sure many of you have seen your gutters and seen things living up there and growing up there, and got plants up there, and it's all yucky and sludgy and messy. So imagine all that that's going into your tank. So you need to set up things. And a leaf eater first flush kit is about $100 to buy, to set. All as one will be eventually. And you need to set them up on each down pipe. That's the idea. Each down pipe. All right, that you back from. Right, we also want to have a quick look at a few slides, just very quickly, about things in at home. You can also look at grey water and rain water. Let's look at, very quickly, irrigation. Well, generally, it's pretty safe to say in today's climate and our falling rainfall, which is here forever, and water things rationing is going to keep going and it's just going to get progressively worse, so I'm letting you know, start becoming self-reliant. You need to change from sprays and sprinklers to be water wise. You need to conserve the water. Now, a hot summer's day with a bit of breeze, about 90% of the water is in the ground. So you need to invest in drip line. The good thing about grey water systems, it is drip line, and you're getting the water to the roots much more effectively, not losing too much by the wind and the sun. We're changing to more water efficient sprinklers that don't guzzle out litres and litres at one time. Only send a small amount, but much more efficient. But all these things are now available. And you can do, you know, garden beds and even lawns, but that provided you do other things like tap filters, etc. But you can irrigate all your gardens with drip line very easily. And drip line comes in so many different types of forms. You know, the purple one, of course, is the grey water line. You get the version that's black for normal garden for bore use. You can get a little mini scape like these things are here, and tech line that you find just for your garden beds to grow your food, and you just get the right one. It's roughly about 80 cents to a dollar a meter. So think about replacing some. But if you're going to replace sprinklers and sprays, do the whole zone. You know, if you've got a whole backyard zone, don't have half sprays and half drip line. You've got to replace all along the one. You might put a pressure reducing valve into the don't have any issues. So there's things you've got to find out about. Landscaping. There are things you can do, right? The story of mulch is pretty common, understandable. Mulches should be used everywhere, especially in WA with our kind of soils, etc. And you don't have to use very fancy, very expensive lucerne hay, okay? You can just use the wood chip stuff, the cheap stuff, the stuff for street prunings. Put yourself down on mulch net, and you get it for free. You might have to wait, but you get it for free. Or you pay $165 to get a truckload, last you the whole year. So think about mulch on garden beds to reduce the evaporation is a wise thing to do. That's the ultimate gardens near my place. But a bit over the top, it was just really to say, you don't have to go to that extreme to be water wise by just having a cactus. You can actually have gardens that are functional and water wise. You can have herbs that are water wise. A lot of the Mediterranean herbs, lavenders, rosemary, are all water wise type herbs. You can have some succulents, you can have some mixture of natives, many natives are water wise. When you think of water wise, doesn't mean native plants. Alright? There are many things that you can have to be water wise and set yourself up. So, in this garden, as an example, there's a water wise lawn. There's a few of them, like Zoysia and Palmetto, that have a couple of water wise lawns with water by grey water. Obviously, drip line through here and fruit trees and other plants, but with mulch to retain the moisture. Everybody should be growing food, as Anne talked about a little while ago. We can do other things as well in terms of putting things in the garden, improving these, building the soil life. And I mentioned earlier that the soil, to me, from my permaculture background, is simply soil is the key. The health of the soil makes healthy people and healthy food. So we want to make sure that we build the soil. And we improve the soil, adding, you know, good compost in there, mulches and other things. We may have to add some amendments. Our soils are notoriously non-wetting, as you'll see shortly. And you can add a whole range of different things. You can add something, for example, some bentonite in sand, holds the moisture. You had clay, you had gypsum to break it up. We had coastal alkaline soils from the coast, you had some sulfur. Because that soil is typically 8 or 9 pH, and when you grow things that don't live very well, you can change soil. Soil is very easy to change by a few handfuls of an amendment. As you can see here from this top photo, I'm sure some of you have had that experience, putting the garden hose on, the water sits there for ages. We have very hydrophobic soils, non-wetting soils, typical of WA. It's often due to, it's due to the culture of the soil particles, the bacteria that coating the soil with waxes, etc. And you can see on the photo on the site here where you might get patches in your lawn, anything on, you know, bugs in there, so probably it's not getting any water. As simple as that. So you can then add things like water crystals, water holding things, you can treat things, a whole lot of stuff, or simply get your laundry trough water and take it out and put that on the garden, but that is just the same as a wetting agent. Your soaking water from the laundry is a wetting agent, and put that onto your soil. This is a problem mainly over the summer months up until the first rain. So when it rains in April, May, typically, you know, around the school holidays, around Easter, and it goes to rain, it all runs away. After a while it does soak in, so we know the nature of the soil changes. But this takes a bit of time, and you can help a little bit here too. Just to finish up, you can see here an example of one institute. This is at Edmund Grove, where a very, very versatile council are using all the toilet waste to water the lawn. They're using a grey water system to water all the plants, the exotics and fruit trees and other things in the children's play area. And they're using all the urine they collect as fertilizer for all these things as well. So, just have a look at what you should do to secure your own water future. I think it's time that you did take this on board and look at the issues at hand. And I'm available to answer some questions for you out there. Thanks very much.